Good morning and welcome to Community Church. In my opinion, this is the best church on the face of the earth because it has great people. It's a giving, caring, loving church. It's a great church family to be a part of, and they even accept me. But seriously, it is such a wonderful reality to worship with you online and to worship here when the occasion and the safe measures that we take permit it. And I'm excited about you joining us. So please watch, and if we can ever be of help to you, contact me, Reverend Dale Brown at the church, and I or a person on my staff will respond to you as fast as we can, and enjoy worship. And even though it's still Advent and Christmas is a little bit out there, Merry Christmas. God bless you. Good morning. In the United Methodist Church, one of the things that I celebrate is the practice of open communion. When we celebrate the sacrament of Holy Communion, or perhaps you call it the Eucharist, or maybe the Lord's Supper, we believe that everybody is welcome to participate. John Wesley, a priest in the Anglican Church who never ever left that church, who simply wanted to reform it but was denied that opportunity and founded Methodism, was serving the sacrament, and he noticed that people who came to the sacrament would come to the altar and they would be saved. And he said to himself in a pragmatic way, who am I to stand in God's way? So this morning we're going to share in the sacrament of Holy Communion. And you'll hear the liturgy and things later, and I invite you to simply, as we share in that sacrament, have something like grape juice and something like a piece of bread that you might share with us. Please know you are welcome at Christ's table because God loves you.
Michelle Mann. We light this second candle as a symbol of Christ. The prophets lead us to the way of salvation. O come, Emmanuel. O God, you so loved the world as to give your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Grant to us the precious gift of faith, that we may know that the Son of God has come and may have power to overcome the world and gain a blessed immortality. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please join me in the call to worship. A voice cries out, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God."
This song is one that I heard for the first time some years ago, and it was immediately haunting to me and something I just had to learn right away. And then I found out it was a favorite of so many, and many people had known of this before I did. It's a song about what Mary might have been feeling. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to the blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm a storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know?
Their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Good morning. My name is Austin Buchiane. I will be reading from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 1, verses 26 to 33. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent by God to a town in Galilee called Nazareth, to a virgin engaged to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. The virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, favored one. The Lord is with you." But she was much perplexed by his words and pondered what sort of greeting this might be. The angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. And now you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you will name him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and Lord God will give to him the throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Please pray with me. O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, my rock and my redeemer. Good morning, and again, welcome to Community Church at Ocean Pines. It's a great privilege to celebrate this season of Advent and Christmas with you. Each of us has our own Christmas traditions. Perhaps we learned them from our families. For us, we open family gifts on Christmas Eve, but we open gifts from Santa Claus on Christmas morning. And even into adulthood, that practice for me is hard to break. Or maybe we pick them up for ourselves from something that was meaningful or important to us. For me, I'd like to begin this sermon this morning with an example of one of those practices that I do each Advent and Christmas. I love music. I think people who are talented like Dick or Jennifer or Sally or any of the persons in the choir or the bell choir or the Psalm 66 band, I am envious of, because the best I can do is a radio on a good day if the wind is blowing in the right direction. So I know nothing about music, except I know history of some pieces of music, but not anything about the technical singing or performing or practicing of them. But many years ago, I fell in love with the Messiah. And so during Advent, at some point, often very close to Christmas or maybe even Christmas Eve morning, I find a secluded place and I sit and listen to the Messiah. Now, part of that is, for me, its deep connection to the Old Testament. I love those prophetic writings of the 12 minor prophets and Isaiah and Jeremiah and Ezekiel, even though Ezekiel is someone who's always a little bit strange or odd or different. But particularly Isaiah. And in the Messiah, as I listen for those words from the prophet that he spoke in the Old Testament to the people who needed to hear a message from God, a message of hope in the midst of their very dark and difficult circumstances. And I love that portion from Isaiah 9 that you heard earlier in our service, where the names of God are lifted up as Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Savior, Prince of Peace. And in other years, I've spent the entire season of Advent talking just about those names, one each week during a sermon. So tonight, as we think about the stories of Christmas, I'd like to focus on one of those names, the Prince of Peace. I was shopping a day or two ago, and I noticed something in the Hallmark store in West Ocean City that I really liked and thought was beautiful and wanted to have. And I'm a pretty good shopper. I look for bargains, I use coupons, I buy when things are on sale, and I don't spend money frivolously. That's probably because I'm a banker's son. But the thing that I saw was the word peace, P-E-A-C-E, spelled out on this little piece of clay or ceramic with the different symbols of Christmas along the top of each letter. I tend to think it was because I thought it was attractive, but I also think it's because in me and in many people, there is a longing for peace in the midst of all that's happening in our world. Perhaps we're looking for peace of mind, or peace of heart, or maybe even peace of soul. Whatever the peace that we're looking for may consist of, we want peace to take over and to fill the void, the absence, the difficulties of conflict and of the war that is being waged against COVID-19 and the pandemic. We want peace to take over and fill the spot where work or employment used to be, as so many now are unemployed. We want peace because we know that in having peace, that means that God's rule and reign is working in the world. We don't have to fear or worry or be anxious, but we can trust God's goodness for us. One of my favorite Christmas stories has to do with this topic of peace. In 1914, the whole world was involved in World War I. It was a brutal conflict, a winner-take-all type of conflict where so many were maimed and killed and damage done and so much loss. I think the estimate, if my memory serves me, is that there were about 150,000 casualties. So much of World War I was fought in the trenches. Lines dug, zigzag, and hopefully moving ever close to the enemy that you might take the shot that would kill them while you were protected in your trench. And as you might imagine, trenches that were 6 or 8 or 10 feet deep would fill with water. And they would become places of human refuse and cold and ice and water and all kinds of stuff. And it was a miserable, horrible, terrible reality. No one wanted to be there as bombs and all other things soared overhead, often burying men in their wake. And it became Christmas Eve, 1914, on a part of the line where the British were facing the Germans. And the Germans began to sing, "O come all ye faithful," in Latin. And the British heard the song, and of course they knew the song, they knew the words, and they responded by singing vigorously in English. So here is the incongruity of it all. In the midst of the conflict of World War I, in this horrible place where so many were far away from home and many of those would never go home, two enemies, two warring nations, two persons, two groups of persons bent on killing one another, singing, "O come all ye faithful." And so finally, one brave soul, and I don't know whether it was a German or a British soldier, popped up and said, "If you don't shoot, we won't shoot." And with that, he climbed over the top of the trench, there had to be that first person. And he was it. And soon hundreds of soldiers were coming into what was the area between called no man's land, and they were talking with one another. They had some Germans who spoke English and some English who spoke German, and they communicated one with another. They asked if the other side had something to drink, an alcoholic beverage or coffee or even water. They began to tell stories and to laugh and to set up Christmas trees with the meager supplies they had. They began a game of what they would call football, what we would call soccer, with hundreds of persons playing. One British soldier who had the ability to cut hair, we know, set up a barbershop. And he charged just a couple of cigarettes to anyone who wanted their hair cut. But in the midst of this great confluence, there was peace. And these soldiers, who just a few moments before had wanted to kill each other, got along. One soldier commented, "If the generals and the politicians would just stay out of it, we could end this tonight. We could all just go home." The next morning was Christmas. And all Christmas Day, there was this truce that broke out spontaneously up and down the lines, where soldiers would not harm or injure one another, where they talked and laughed and told stories and thought of home. But on December 26th, all that was done. The shooting started again. The bombs came. The anger, the hatred, the dislike, the belief that the only good person on the other side was a dead soldier. They were right back at it. The peace, which was manufactured by humans, lasted only a brief time. There's something about that story that I find very uplifting. That if given the chance, we can find our way to peace. But the part of that story that makes me have some level of despair is that for us as people, that peace that we configure, that we create, that we build, that we manufacture, is short-lived. That it doesn't last, because it's all too easy to go back into the patterns of the past. One of the remarkable things about the kingdom of God coming in full, about God's reign and rule being the way that we live together on earth, is that we are participating in a peace that lasts forever. I have a picture in my office. It's a picture of the founding of the colony of Pennsylvania. Now, I'm not from Pennsylvania, I'm from here, but I think it's one of those great and beautiful pictures that comes from another portion of the prophet Isaiah's writings. And in the background, you see William Penn, the Quaker, wanting to treat the Native Americans well and to establish good relationships. And you see them talking and standing together and shaking hands and doing all the things that were a part of the founding of this colony. But Edward Hicks puts in the foreground the animals, the peaceable kingdom, the lion and the lamb, those animals that are natural enemies, laying side by side, sitting side by side, because God's kingdom has no need for violence. It is a kingdom of peace. On this Christmas season, one of the great gifts that we can give and receive is peace. In the midst of our anxiety and our worry and our fear, Christ comes in the beauty of the manger, which was really a harsh way to come into this world, but Christ comes in its beauty and brings with it the hope that today and in days in the future and ultimately forever, there will be peace. Peace between people, where there doesn't need to be violence of words or action. Peace between different kinds and groups of people, ethnicities and people who normally might be at enmity with each other, that God is coming and God will bring with God's self peace forever. Peace between nations, peace that covers the whole world. I don't know about you, but I long for that day. I grow weary of listening to people argue, of listening to people blame one another, of the accusations of wrongdoing or being a bad person, or if that person would just change, then I long for the peace that God offers. So in this season of Advent, I suggest we begin by treating one another, those that we like and those with whom we differ, with the peace with which we desire to be treated. To treat them with the kindness, the love, the acceptance, the peace that comes from God, filling our heart with God's peace. Because again, we can't make it on our own. We tend to fall back into acts of violence. We tend to dislike one another or to blame one another or somehow think that the person who is other is bad. But God comes and brings peace to us and to our world. And I think we can simply ask God for that peace. You know, the Bible tells us that when we pray, when we ask for something, God is faithful to us and God grants it. Sometimes we don't realize it or know it until the experience is right there before us, but God's peace is with us, that quiet confidence that allows us to treat one another as persons of value, persons loved by God. So let's begin today. We'll make mistakes. I'll make mistakes. I'll mess it up sometime. But if it's on our mind and in our heart, and God has gifted this peace to us, we can share it. And I think even perhaps a little bit more importantly in this day when there is so much stress, so much worry, so much anxiety, and it seems as if things go good for about 2 minutes and then they go bad for about 22 minutes. Maybe we need God's peace in our own heart. I have peace today because even though I don't know the way, I don't know the means or the method or the how-tos, I know that God is in control. My son would say, God's got it. And that's the truth. I don't know when. I don't know how. But I know God. And even though times are stressful, and it seems as if there's just one more negative bad thing after another, those things are not nearly as important as the character of God. And God's character is to be a giver of peace. Jesus, in some of the most difficult times in his life, experienced peace and offered peace to others. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled Do not let them be afraid. We can receive the peace of God. I told you just a few weeks ago as I close that don't ever give me a Christmas gift ahead of time and expect me to wait to unwrap it. Because I'm shaking that box, I'm trying to look through the paper to see if there's a thin spot. I'm even kind of along where the tape goes, running my finger through there and trying to see if I could just pop it open enough that I could re-tape it if need be. And that's for stuff that doesn't last. Stuff that I want or was given, which I am thankful for, but doesn't last long. Boy, if we could be that excited to open God's peace, we would be different. And so would God's will. One of the portions of Scripture says, to whom much has been given, much is expected. I think that means in terms of our talents and abilities, and I also think it means our possessions and our finance. You have blessed this church by your faithful giving. Every time I drive by the Nook, I notice so many wonderful items that are placed on the porch that can be resold and the money used to help this church and its ministries and mission and to help others. Even though we don't receive an offering because of safety measures for COVID-19, there's an offering box, and every week through that or through our electronic giving or through just stopping by and dropping off an envelope, this church continues to be blessed by your faithful, generous giving. Now, let me say first, thank you. Secondly, please don't stop. It's important because there are persons who are dependent upon the ministries and mission of this church for the help they need. I am so thrilled to say to you that there are people in our community who have food to eat, clothes to wear, a place to live, functioning electric and other utilities, medical appointments, all of these things cared for because of the generosity of persons who give to this church. And I make you my personal promise, and I make this promise on behalf of my financial staff as well. We will do everything to be as faithful and as frugal and as careful with the money that you give. Our books are open. We have no secrets. We will be faithful to honor your gift by using it well to help others. Thank you for your giving, and may God bless your gift and you as the giver. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us lift up our hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord, our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity, made covenant to be our sovereign God, and spoke to us through your prophets, who looked for that day when justice shall roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream, when nation shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ, whom you sent in the fullness of time to be the light to the nations. You scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts and have mercy on those who fear you from generation to generation. You put down the mighty from their thrones and exalt those of low degree. You fill the hungry with good things, and the rich you send away empty. Your own Son came among us as a servant, to be Emmanuel, your presence with us. Jesus humbled himself in obedience to your will and freely accepted death on a cross. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of death. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine or juice. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And let us at this time pray with the confidence of the children of God. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. If you are prepared at this time, please take the bread and eat. And if you are prepared, please take the cup and drink. And in receiving and the giving of the Lord's sacrament, may you be blessed, knowing that Christ is present with you. Amen. At this time, I invite you to join me in prayer for one another. Normally, after our prayer, we would have a moment of silence and the Lord's Prayer. However, in the United Methodist Book of Worship and our hymnal, the Lord's Prayer occurs during the sacrament of Holy Communion. So we will simply close with Amen this morning. Please pray with me. Almighty and great God, wonderful Counselor, mighty God, everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, your greatness, God, astounds us, and yet you willingly came as a baby, born to Mary and Joseph, in a manger of Bethlehem. I give thanks for the gift of this wonderful baby to this world, to my life, to your life, to our lives. And I pray that this same Christ who will grow and mature and become an adult and in his adult manhood go to the cross and die there and rise again might be a part of your life even during this Christmas season. Gracious God, for those persons who are wrestling with what faith means, bless them because I can think of no better season than this season to accept Christ for themselves. For those persons who might be struggling with COVID-19 related illnesses or other kinds of illnesses, I pray for their healing and wholeness, and I give thanks for doctors and nurses and medicines and others who work to care for these dear persons. For persons who are dealing with financial struggles, economic realities, the problems of unemployment or business loss or just sheer struggle, I pray as well. And on this Sunday, when we think and talk of peace, I pray that your peace might rule and reign in our hearts with abundance, and that we might share it with one another and with the world. All this we pray in Christ's name. Amen. It is my privilege to say to you, thank you for joining us in worship. Thank you for being here as we gather to praise and celebrate the great and wonderful love of God. I am still personally deeply astounded that God loved this world so much that God gave his only son. I'm a parent. And I cannot imagine giving my son for anything or anyone. I'd rather give my own life or myself instead. So thank you as we celebrate the birth of Jesus, the coming of Christ into the world during this Advent season and Christmas in just a few weeks. Many, many years ago, I heard a sermon, and that sermon talked about how are your Christmas preparations going. And in the sermon, the speaker talked about the decorating of the tree and the purchasing and wrapping of gifts and the planning of the meal and all that goes into making this that very special time of year that it is. But then he, at the end, kind of surprised us because he said, how are your Christmas preparations in your heart, in your life, in your mind, in your soul going? And so this week, in between times of worship, again, if I can help you with the preparation of your life and your soul, your spirit, please call me at church, contact me. But how are your preparations going? Please hear these words of benediction. And now may God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit bless, preserve, and keep you now and forever. Amen.